Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Sheila Bauman, and I'm the events planner for Kitchener Public Library, and I'm pleased to welcome you to tonight's event. Before we begin, I would like to start with a land acknowledgement. As we gather, we are reminded that the library is situated on land that is the traditional home of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Neutral people. We recognize and deeply appreciate their historic connection to this place. We also recognize the contributions Indigenous peoples have made in shaping and strengthening this community. We are grateful for the opportunity to meet here and reaffirm our collective commitment to make the promise and the challenge of truth and reconciliation real in our community. Thanks to each of you for being here tonight. Kitchener Public Library extends thanks to the City of Kitchener's ImagineIt Fund for sponsoring this event. We also want to say thanks to HarperCollins Canada and publicists Michael Miller and Dave Knox for their support of our author events in Kitchener, both past live events and now virtual. There will be time for Q&A following the author discussion, and we invite you to use the Q&A feature. We will monitor the pop-up, and as time permits, questions will be sent to the authors to answer. Now to tonight's author event. I'm thrilled you could join us for another book launch and an opportunity to hear about the story, the research, and the history behind The Library of Legends. It is a fascinating history lesson and read. I extend a warm virtual welcome to both Janie Chang and Jennifer Robson, and I'm looking forward to tonight's conversation with these ladies. They are part of a trio of authors that previously took to the road, and they named that trip the hashtag Hysterical Fiction Tour. I'll pose the first question of the night and ask them at some point to share a story from that adventure. But at this time, I want to share a bio of tonight's interviewer. Jennifer Robson is an academic by background, a former editor by profession, and a lifelong history nerd. And as she says, she's lucky enough to call herself a full-time writer. She studied French literature and modern history as an undergraduate at King's University College at Western University, and then attended St. Anthony's College at the University of Oxford, where she obtained her doctorate in British economic and social history. She is the author of six novels set during and after the two world wars, including the USA Today bestseller, The Gown, and her forthcoming novel, Our Darkest Night, a novel of Italy and the Second World War, which will be released January 5th, 2021. At this time, I invite Jennifer to the screen, and she will introduce tonight's 85 Queen special guest, Janie Chang. Janie will do a short reading from her book, and Jennifer will then join her on screen again for a fabulous discussion about Janie's book, The Library of Legends, and hopefully some stories from their road trip. Welcome, Jennifer.
Hello, everyone. I'm so glad to be here and to get to interview my wonderful friend, Janie. So Janie Chang writes fiction with personal connections, drawing from a family history with, get this, 36 generations of recorded genealogy. She grew up listening to stories about life in a small Chinese town in the years before the Second World War, as well as tales of ancestors who encountered dragons, ghosts, and immortals. Her first novel, Three Souls, was a finalist for the 2014 BC Book Prize's Fiction Prize. And her second novel, Dragon Springs Road, was a Globe and Mail national bestseller. Both were nominated for the International Dublin Literary Award. Her third book, The Library of Legends, released in April 2020, is a Globe and Mail national bestseller. Born in Taiwan, Janie has lived in the Philippines, Iran, Thailand, and New Zealand. She now lives in beautiful Vancouver with her husband and Misha, a rescue cat who thinks the staff could be doing a much better job. So welcome, Janie. It's lovely to see your face again. And I'm hoping we can see Janie up on screen in a second, as well as my own self. Janie and I first met a number of years ago when we were working on, or rather, Janie had created the annual event called Authors for Indies.
Right.
Hi, Janie.
Hi.
Here you are.
I know. And actually, we met through another mutual author friend, Kate Hilton, who suggested that you would be able to write a wonderful blog piece in support of independent bookstores. Right.
And yeah, and that started, you know, I mean, I'd known of you, right? I mean, how could I not have as a Canadian writer? But it was lovely to be able to make that connection directly. And then, so I was involved with Authors for Indies for a few years because you and I, and of course our mutual friend, Kate Hilton, we all believe really passionately that independent local bookstores are absolutely invaluable
essential.
For Canadian readers and Canadian
essential
writers
to
too.
So and we should say the partner bookstore tonight is Wordsworth Books in Waterloo. So
everyone, thank you for being part of this event for us.
And I just want to say that my local bookstore, which is Main Street Book Warehouse in Vancouver, they have my credit card on file. So, you know, it's really easy for me to email them and order my books. And then I get to go along and pick them up and have a nice chat.
Yeah. I have an alarmingly long list of books that I'm making up for Christmas giving that I'm about to drop off with the lovely people at A Novel Spot Books in Etobicoke, which is my local indie. And you know, I know it's sometimes it feels very convenient to order, you know, online from a large kind of multinational. But you know, local booksellers are really, I feel in some ways like they're the heartbeat of our communities, mm-hmm. in small towns particularly. But even in a big city like Toronto, you get that small town service when you go into a bookshop like A Novel Spot or Book City, or any of the lovely small stores that have popped up again in recent years. It's lovely to see this resurgence of independent bookstores.
And for me, there's such a difference between going on to an online retailer and then they'll say, well, if you like this book, then our algorithm will tell you that you will also love this book. But I can go into my local bookstore and say, James, I'm just feeling so blue. What do you have that if I read it, I wouldn't feel so lonely? And he knows exactly what I need, right? So,
well, and I feel the algorithm sometimes has very strange notions of what I'm actually interested in reading, which sometimes very, you know, and I'll go, maybe I'll have gone online to buy, you know, some kind of cleanser. And then, you know, the books that are generated from that can be not really my cup of tea. But beyond all that,
we should get back on agenda because
I know
because
the thing
right now,
what I want to talk about too is just briefly before we dig into the book is we often as authors, when we do these co-events, we get asked, are you really friends with the other author? Do you know the other author? And we can honestly say, yes, we're friends. We talk about, well, we talk mostly about books because it's fun. It's our work. That's where I get so many great ideas from you, Janie, and from my other writer friends. But we have text threads. We have our kind of, I don't think it's secret anymore, but we are represented by the same literary agent, wonderful woman called Kevin Lyon. And we have a group on Facebook now of many of her writers. And we call ourselves the Lionesses. And that's been just, I don't know, I found
great
it
support.
Wonderful in terms of
sanity inducing sometimes.
Yeah, yeah. So. It's almost as if we have almost like a little collective or a union in some ways, just in terms of airing kind of questions we have for each other, mm-hmm. and knowing that we're not alone sometimes when something odd happens or perplexing. And so we really do know each other. And and so when you see the blurbs, and the blurbs are these words of praise that appear on book covers and book jackets. A lot of the time, the reason that a blurb will be on a book jacket is because the authors know each other, and one author has reached out to another and said, would you be so kind as to read my book? And Janie, you did that recently for me. And I have to say, Lou, words of praise coming from you, you know, mean... Oh, I always feel I have to kind of take to my fainting couch after one of my writer friends has said something.
The thing is, because we both write historical fiction, we both love the genre, and you know, we recognize good writing when we see it. It's not a chore. To do the blurbs and say, oh, do I get an advanced copy so that I can read?
It's a great perk, though. I mean, we get to read these amazing books months before a lot of other people do. And I try not to boast about it too much online. I feel like, you know, life is tough enough now without showing off my early copy of a book that other people won't be able to look at for ages. But you know what, before we could, the two of us could go on like this for the entire evening, but I want to talk about the inspirations for this wonderful book, which once again has, I mean, HarperCollins knocks it out of the park really every time with book covers. This, and I remember when you were getting options for the book cover in terms of different, I mean, so many of them were beautiful, but this one, I mean, I have this actually in my living room most of the time. And well, back when people came to my house, people would look at it and go, oh my gosh, that is stunning.
So, and may I point out to you that behind me, there is this huge banner suitable for trade shows and for going on tour with a book, which our publisher, HarperCollins, sent to me in the early spring in anticipation of book tours that never happened. So Neil from HarperCollins Marketing, I'm trying to use it as much as I can.
Well, and you know, I mean, these, for all that we're kind of constrained by these circumstances and we can't leave our homes and see people in person, I do feel we're able to meet a lot of people through these Zoom meetups that otherwise might not have been able to come out in person.
There's no geographical barriers, and that's the silver lining I always look at.
So let's start in. I want to talk about your inspirations for the book, because, you know, as I alluded to earlier, having a family history that stretches to 36 generations, I'm telling you, my family history, I don't know, maybe we can go back five or six, right? And it's nothing very interesting. It's probably coal miners in the north of England, but 36 documented generations. That's blowing my mind. I didn't know that until this evening, that they went back that far.
Right. Well, in terms of inspiration, it's more recent family history. The Library of Legends is set in 1937 China, when war breaks out between China and Japan, and the main character is a young woman named Lian, and she has to follow her university because war has cut them off from their families, and the entire campus evacuates to the interior of China. And this is the students, the professors, the staff and servants at the university. They walk 1,000 miles to safety, and they carry their belongings and school supplies and even kitchenware. But even more importantly, they carry with them an incredible priceless collection of Chinese books called the Library of Legends. And Lian, the main character, has always been cautious about opening up to her feelings, but this experience on the road opens up new friendships and possibly even romance. But family secrets make her a victim of political manipulation, and she has to turn away from her friends, especially after a classmate is found murdered and another one is arrested. So the reason I decided to write about this is because my father was one of those students who had to pack up everything with his university campus in 1937 and walk from sort of coastal eastern China all the way into the interior, into southwestern China, you know, sort of walking through war zones and cut off from his family. The only money that he had was sort of an allowance that the government gave them. And it turns out that this, the evacuation of Chinese universities during the war is a story that's not very well known at all outside of China. But what really clinched it for me was when I was doing my initial research and I came across memoirs by the alumni of another one of these universities, 77 universities in all out of 114 in China, you know, evacuated. And one of these other universities, they just sort of mentioned that, oh, and by the way, when we traveled, we carried with us 230 crates of books from this, you know, like priceless collection that of books that was commissioned by the Emperor of China in the Qing Dynasty. And we carried it to safety. And all I didn't know about it. No one outside of China even knows about it. And then as a writer, as you're formulating ideas for how the book should work out, it's like, it's a freaking entire priceless library. Yeah. How much metaphor, how much symbolism can you carry with that, right?
Well, so, you know, you've hit gold. Like, that's the kind of discovery where sometimes it feels as if you wish, occasionally I've had moments like that, and you think, if only I had the power to extract everything that's in my head right now and get it down immediately without this whole thing of having to write or type. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like the ideas are there's too many ideas to fit in your head. Mm-hmm. Just this, you know, and one discovery of one kind of golden nugget like that. To me is incredible. Just the fact that they walked so far. I remember when I first read your book, and I couldn't visualize 1,000 miles. I think maybe I'm a child of the metric system. Mm-hmm. But when I kind of figured out how far it was, that would, where I live in Toronto, that would take me to Georgia in the United States. Mm-hmm. That's when I thought, oh, that's a significant distance.
Right. I don't know how I'm going to do this, but I do have a link on my blog from July 5th, because I actually wrote an article for Time magazine, and it's about the true history behind the Library of Legends.
Yeah.
So maybe we'll see what I can do is maybe just copy and paste it into the chat. Into the chat. And then maybe Sheila can put it out there for the people that we can.
Oh, there it is. Yeah. It's in here for the panelists, so we can share it with everyone.
It was a golden moment, Jen. It really was.
Golden. And I still, because we were traveling together with wonderful Kate Quinn, who wrote The Alice Network. The Huntress has a new book coming out soon that will blow your mind. Yeah. And I remember, I feel like we were maybe in Whistler that night, mm-hmm. and we started talking about just the first glimmerings of ideas for this book. And I remember looking at Kate and thinking, this sounds like gold to me. It just sounds incredible. I basically felt like, well, could you just have that ready for me to read in a week or two, Janie, that would be terrific, because I don't know if I can wait.
So, Sheila has asked me to do a reading, just a really brief one. And so I'm picking out a segment of the book, which was actually based on a true event in history. It was the one that made hair stand up on the back of my neck and made me decide I have to write on this topic. So this is from a scene where the students have been walking on the road with other refugees milling around when a Japanese plane came in and attacked and strafed them. And this is what happens in the aftermath of the attack. The road was pockmarked with bullet holes. The small stone bridge had been strafed. Some students stood in a circle staring down while others looked away. Gaps between their legs revealed a figure lying still on the ground, a dark blue uniform tunic and trousers, black cloth shoes, a smear of blood. The victims they had seen on the road a few hours ago had been nameless and faceless, but now the dead had a name. Shen had been one of their own. The circle of students parted, and Professor Kang arrived, bringing with him two of the university's laborers. The two men wrapped Shen's body in a tarp, then lifted the bundle onto a hand cart. They began pushing it up the road to join the caravan, which was slowly moving again. "We'll be at the monastery very soon," the professor said. "I will ask the monks to look after the burial." He then knelt on the ground to write on a small chalkboard. It had holes at the corners and a rope looped through the holes. His movements were quick and precise as he wrote down lines from a poem. "Though rainfall bends the river grass, a bird is singing. While ghosts of the six dynasties pass like a dream around the forbidden city under weeping willows, which loom for 3 miles along the misty moat. That is from a Nanking landscape by the Tang Dynasty poet Wei Zhuang, he said. Learn it by heart, consider its meaning, and when you write your essays, remember the politics of his time. He put his arms through the ropes and shouldered the chalkboard. Then they continued the journey, the elderly professor walking in front of his students, the day's lesson hanging down his back. So that
has me all choked up, Jamie.
That was actually something that a friend of mine told me about. You know, he had read a memoir from one of these students, and that was an actual incident. And for me, it was just so emblematic of the Chinese regard for education. And I just remember, you know, I mean, I had a friend who said when she read the book, she said, you know, here I am stuck at home, pandemic, trying to homeschool my children, but at least I'm not walking through a war zone, you know. But I also want to point out something that I didn't bring into the novel because it would just have opened up the topic so much more, but it wasn't just the university students who were doing this. There were kids from boarding school, you know, like middle school, who were cut off from their families. And the whole teacher student or school and student relationship in China is a very, very strong one. It's almost a filial, it's almost like a family relationship. Mm-hmm. And there's such an obligation, such a duty of care of the school. So there were actually teachers walking, you know, 14-year-olds through a war zone to get them to safety.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, and I, you know, we'll touch upon this back and forth as we go through the evening, but it really is, you know, a book like this is, it's such a salutary reminder of, you know, relatively speaking, how easy our lives are for so many of us. And, you know, even, I mean, times have been tough for a lot of people recently, but there's nothing like reading an account like what happens to your characters to make you realize, well, you know, there are definitely worse things than having to stay home for a little bit, and or, you know, homeschooling children, which I have to say was brought me to my knees this spring. You know, it's and I think that's one of the reasons that the books set in this era are so particularly popular right now. It's easy to appreciate how much we have when we contrast it against what people were living through. But also it's really nice to have a World War II story, era story, from a perspective that's not set in Europe. And I say that as somebody who routinely writes about Europe, but, you know, to just move out of that one theater of war and see what was happening elsewhere, and that it's a story that's so relatively unknown.
And I love, this is what I love about writing historical fiction, is that we get to pick a time and characters who we feel are deserving of more attention, mm-hmm. right? And at the same time, I think a lot of the things that we write about, all of my historical fiction author friends sort of have this motivation to write about social injustice. Mm-hmm. That's happened in the past, but I think it also helps us to put a lens on the fact that, you know, some of these things are still happening in the world around us mm-hmm. now, so that we can bring people sort of gradually through a historical time frame into understanding how terrible it was. So, for example, one of in my second book, Dragon Springs Road, there are descriptions of children working in silk factories and, you know, dipping their fingers into vats of boiling water to pick the silk cocoons out mm-hmm. when they were ready. And It was horrible. It was going on in China. They were hot. They used children whose fingers were considered more sensitive, you know, to pick out the cocoons. But guess what? Those descriptions that I got were straight out of a UNICEF set of articles about the silk industry in India, where they mm-hmm. use child labor. You know, mm-hmm. so I think mm-hmm. you know there are different ways of bringing harsh realities. Awareness of harsh realities into mm-hmm. people's mm-hmm. lives. And I guess our chosen medium is to write historical fiction.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, cause I always feel as if I, you know, I trained to be a teacher and I never ended up teaching. And this is my, my alternate route to it, which I have to say being a writer is the world's easiest gig compared to being a teacher in a classroom. So I, you know, I took the easy way out, I have to say, but it is, you know, that's, if there's anything that propels me forward on the tough days with writing, it's the thought that maybe someone will read just something in one of my books and be drawn to learn more, all right, to dig in and pick up another book about the subject. I'm just going to add, there's some children outside of my backyard who are making a lot of noise right now, okay. So I'm going to shut the window.
All right. So I think that raised,
there we are.
You're raising a really good point, Jennifer, which is that historical fiction, I see it as a way of opening the doors, like the gateway drug, to actually learning more about actual history, you know. And this is something that we've talked about, you know, amongst ourselves, but what really drives us crazy is when people come up to us at parties and say, oh, you write historical fiction. That must be so easy because you already know how the story ends. And you know, you're clutching the stem of your wine glass and trying not to pick it up.
Yeah, thinking if it snaps, will the glass cut my hand? Because I think it's going to snap any minute now.
Yeah. And the thing is, you know, what we are actually constrained to write within the boundaries of certain historical facts, but you know, you still need to fill up 100,000 words of story. And just because Churchill did this at the beginning and he did this at the end, how do you tease a story out of it? How do you come up with fiction that's still plausible? Mm-hmm. How do you create characters that readers will care about? Yeah. So it's not easier.
Yeah. It's a little bit harder than just going through, you know, the history of World War II, copying down some dates and filling in a few bits here and there. I mean, I wish, and there's the eternal question of how much do you fictionalize in the stories, which, you know, and every author has a different approach to this. You know, mine has always been to have fictional central characters set against a backdrop that's grounded in the history of a period and with, you know, here and there, real historical figures popping in and out if I can plausibly place them in the narrative. But then we both have friends who write about actual named historical personages and write kind of historical biographies that are wonderful.
So brave, you know, like Bryn Turnbull's latest, the woman before Wallace. I wouldn't have the guts to do that, really.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, and that, I mean, it's we're all part of the same kind of the same, I guess, subgenre of fiction. But even then, I mean, just the approach we take when assessing how to weave together these strands of fact and fiction, it differs with every author. I don't think there's any one answer of how to do it right.
But you know what? I think that because we are both history nerds, we really want the background of the story to be as plausible, be as historically accurate as possible. And people sometimes think it's just a matter of getting your timelines right. Mm. But I think there's just way more to that. So my classic, the classic one that I've gotten is, I write about Chinese women before the world wars, obviously. So I get this, I wish your women could be more feminist, right? And on a good day, I'll say something nice, which I will tell you about later. On bad days, I really feel like snapping, you know, you try and be a feminist when you've got bound feet, you're never allowed outside of the house, and you weren't taught how to read, you know, like, but having said that, if you are going to have like an extraordinary young woman, then it is incumbent upon the author to create a situation where it is plausible. How did she learn how to read? Perhaps it was because she was an only child and not having a son, you know, the father lavished education on this girl. You know, how did she, and so she was, you know, open to more ideas, for example, yeah. You know, why did she not have bound feet? It's really hard to go off on adventures on these little yeah. tiny 3-inch feet, but, you know, maybe her mother was Manchurian and they did not bind women's feet, or, you know, maybe they just left it too long because they hated hearing her cry, so they just left it, or they were so wealthy that it didn't matter if she didn't have tiny feet, they had a huge dowry to offset that.
Yeah, so, yeah. So and right there, you've introduced all sorts of scenarios that are not only, again, you and I talk about this a lot. It's not just possible, right? But you've made it plausible. It fits within the history that we know. And that's the difference. It's, you know, people, and we, you know, and I'm not dissing anyone in particular, but, you know, occasionally you'll pick up a book that's historical fiction and something just doesn't sit right as you're reading it. And I think a lot of the time what's happened is there's a bit of almost a surface reading of the history. So they may have incorporated events or characters reacting in a certain way or behaving in a certain way. That's possible. But it doesn't feel true. It doesn't feel plausible. You know, they may have a character, a young woman who's absolutely fearless and acts in a way that would be very familiar to young women of the 21st century, but it isn't grounded in any explanation for why she would have a personality that's in some ways makes her very out of step with her peers. I mean, she can be that way. You just have to, you have to find a way to that it makes sense.
There's so many anachronisms I discovered while writing that have nothing to do with timeline or sequence of events or something, because as you say, it's how do the characters respond to events, to something that happens? So their response should be consistent with their gender, their position in society, their wealth, their profession, their level of education. All of those things need to be mirrored consistently, right? Yeah. I just think that this is a story that I tell, which is the first time I was totally paralyzed writing my first novel was when, you know, I realized that I went to school in the West, okay? We use quotes from Shakespeare all over the place, right? And everybody knows references to Dickens or to Greek and Roman mythology and all that stuff. And it suddenly occurred to me that in my character in 1928 China, there's no way that her expressions, her speech pattern would ever incorporate any of those references, right? Yeah. And for writers, that's like this entire toolbox of metaphors that if you just had to throw out the window. And like, I could barely talk for 3 days when I realized I'd have to get around it, you know?
But without at the same time having her speak in a way that made it sound as if it had been translated directly from, say, Mandarin. It has to, her voice has to sound authentic and her voice, but without incorporating anachronistic kind of, you know, Western idioms. But even, you know, even when I'm just working, just confined to Europe, it's so easy to let idioms creep in that have no place in something that's even said as recently as the 1940s. You know, I'm constantly, you know, occasionally I'll read historical fiction and set in the 1920s, and they have people using, you know, they're using the phrase "okay," for example, which if you look at the etymology of the word, it in theory existed, but it wasn't mm-hmm. in widespread use. And but you do find yourself kind of thinking, oh my gosh, I've got to go back over the entire manuscript and double, triple check that I haven't made some of me. And even then I make mistakes with every book. I mean, it's inevitable. And then that's when the emails, if you're lucky, it's a friendly email and somebody who is gently pointing out the mistake. And then sometimes people can get really angry. Like when September 31st made it into the date, September 31st made it into one of my books.
Yeah,
and I wanted to explain that wasn't on purpose.
That is what we jokingly refer to as a rite of passage. When you write historical fiction, your first boo-boo being pointed out to you. And I think that's where our friendships come in so helpfully, because
as we share the nasty grams or the moments where we've realized we've, you know, there's been this terrible boo-boo that we've made, and how do we, you know, luckily the book hasn't been printed yet, how do I walk back from it?
Or,
oh my god, you know,
the book's been printed, but that's okay, tell your publisher, they'll revise the ebook, and that can be uploaded, you know, corrected and uploaded right away. So there, talk you off the ledge.
Exactly, as I get up my paper bag in which I'm going to hyperventilate. You know, and I know we've been talking about process a little bit, but I want to talk about how you go about researching your books, because you don't take shortcuts. This is, you know, it takes you a long time.
So do you. I mean, I've got an entire... like I have 10 feet worth of shelf space, and it's now all reference non-fiction books. You start off doing the cheap and free stuff. You start looking it up on Wikipedia, but Wikipedia, the copy editors don't allow you to use as references. So then you go to, you know, the sources at the bottom of the Wikipedia article, you go online, you search. I love using JSTOR. I have taken out a membership there. It's academic papers, and there's all kinds of stuff you can find on there.
I should add that a lot of the public libraries, if you have a library card for the big public library systems here and in the States, many of them will include digital access to not always JSTOR, but to many of the large academic kind of databases. Yeah. And I don't know what I would do without my Toronto Public Library card. I'm sure the Kitchener Public Library has, again, digital access for its patrons, so that if you can't, you know, get into one of the big library systems, like physically get there, there are a lot of things you can access online. And I know, I mean, it's been transformative for me, the digitization of so many sources. Makes it a little harder now. In the before times, I always felt a little guilty saying to my husband, so I absolutely need to go to France for this research trip. It's paramount importance. And then of course, I mean, the reality is I can do almost everything.
It is.
And hopefully he's not watching this.
The problem for us, Jen, is never doing the research. It's when to stop.
Yeah.
Because
usually sometimes that requires an actual email from my editor telling me, Jen, just stop. Mm-hmm. Just, you have to write this book. The deadline's looming. Will you we'll fill in the empty spots later. Just get writing. And that's usually the kick in the pants I need. But for this, tell me, I think people will be interested in hearing a little bit about how you dug into the story and the kind of sources you relied upon.
You know, I think for both of us, what is difficult in terms of research is not so much those dates and the battles and, you know, what planes flew during that time, because there's all kinds of military history. Mm-hmm. What we care about, because we're writing about people, we tend to write about ordinary women trying to survive in extraordinary times. Mm-hmm. I always end up trying to look for memoirs. so that we can hear the voices of those women, so we can hear about them. I had to go work in the munitions factory all day, come home, queue up for food on my way home, you know, try and feed four children once I got home, mm-hmm. and put them to bed and worry about, you know, what happens when their shoes wear out and do it all over again the next day. You know, those are the type, mm-hmm. just the ordinary minutia of life is what's really, really hard to find.
Yeah. Like what people ate, what they wore,
what they read for fun, what they did for fun.
All of those little details, which don't make it into the big official history books. There's nothing. Mm-hmm. You won't find anything there about what ordinary people did to survive in times of war. Totally dependent on them, on memoirs and oral histories as well.
Or some oral histories. And of course, when I'm doing stuff in research about China, I don't read Chinese. My father was right. I should learn how to read and write Chinese, but what did I know back then? But foreign missionaries, they kept like copious records of mm-hmm. what they did and what the people were like. And, you know, when photography came in, they were the ones taking pictures, and a picture can really, reveal so much of mm-hmm. what is going on. So yeah, we start with, you know, like the big picture of what was happening during that time in life in history. And then we want to try and zoom in. Once we have a better idea of who our characters are, try and pick up biographies, memoirs, find photographs, really. Mm-hmm.
Chinese government at this time, were they documenting this move inland by the universities for propaganda purposes at all? Are there any records that were left?
So my problem is that because I'm not literate in Chinese, mm-hmm. I had to rely on the memoirs of the students mm-hmm. Who survived the experience. And of course, my own father, my father's stories, my uncle's mm-hmm. stories, my mom's stories. I'm not aware of them. I mean, it's well known in China. So I don't know what kind of literature was left over.
And I mean, well, because it was a century of turmoil for China. It's not as if the war ended and suddenly peace and tranquility descended across the land. I mean, there's ample room for many more exciting books. You don't just have to end with this book. Although do you feel you can talk even like a tiny bit about your work in progress? I will totally understand if you want to keep it under wraps. You're moving closer to where I have a comfort level in terms of writing.
And I have yet to dump my questions on you, Jen. Well, my next novel, I'm working on it right now. I'm 40,000 words into it, and that's after ripping out 10 and, you know, rewriting it, which is something we all deal with.
Oh, gosh, yes.
Yeah. it's actually set in World War I France in the months preceding the armistice, and it is about, it's about a young Chinese girl who has to go to the front. And I won't tell you exactly why, because that's kind of the plot of the story. But the reason that I wanted to write about World War I is because at the Western Front at the time, there were more than 140,000 Chinese workers. The French and the British had recruited Chinese men to work there mm-hmm. because after the Battle of the Somme, basically Europe had run out of men. And every worker, every foreign worker was one more French or British person, soldier, who could actually go to war. Mm-hmm. So that was one less person who had to dig the trenches, carry away the dead and the dying, work in factories, you know, because the factories were decimated. They had women working in factories.
Yeah. You know, it's 1917 when you first start seeing this. Up to that point, the Allies have been very reluctant to put women in uniform in any capacity and to have them in the theaters of war. And so you see women actually taking up these behind the lines positions mm-hmm. to free men up as cannon fodder, really. Right. But you also, and you know, I profess total ignorance of this until you started telling me about your work in progress. But for the pioneer battalions that also had been decimated, they were desperate for labor so that they could keep, I mean, just, you know, it's not as if the trenches were dug and that was it. I mean, they had to be maintained.
They had to be maintained. They had to be, it was basically what you would call the Army Corps of Engineers, what they would be doing right now. And they were manufacturing those bundles of fascines that they put in front of tanks so that, you know, you throw them into the trenches so then the tanks could roll across and not fall. And just all kinds of stuff that was going on. And I think it's only been in the last 10 years that there has been some sort of official acknowledgement. So, as usual, we could go on nerding about
this. We should at some point, we should just do Jen and Janie's History Nerd Hour and invite people to write in. I do have some questions for you, Janie. So I'm going to start with a question from Sarah, which is, what was your hardest scene to write? And I presume this is a scene from the Library of Legends.
Well, first of all, Sarah, the whole research was just really, really difficult because it's about war, and war is just so brutal. And the university starts out in Nanking and they leave before the horrible, horrible Nanking massacre. But even just reading about the stuff that happened peripheral to the actual massacre, like, it was enough to send me into, you know, spirals of despair. So I think there was one scene near the beginning that was really, really difficult, which was when the students begin encountering refugees on the road. And I think that for me, this was very difficult because it was for the Chinese of that generation, you were so bound to your home. You know, mm-hmm. it was your home, it was your ancestry, it was maybe where your family for generations had been the town carpenter or the farm worker or whatever. So there was so much of your identity that was wrapped up in it. And for me, the scenes of refugees having to leave all that behind, leaving behind not just material assets, but their identities, their mm-hmm. absolute identities, and not knowing if they would ever be able to go back. No, those refugee scenes were very, very difficult.
Yeah. I have another question here from June. Sorry, this is me and my terrible reading glasses letting me down. She wants to know, how long did it take to come up with this line, which she turns very evocative, the day's lesson hanging down his back. And she says it has such pull to it, which I absolutely agree. It's the reading you gave, it never fails to give me the shivers, to be honest.
Yeah, and that was the scene that gave me absolute shivers. So June, that was almost a word for word translation of what my friend, who obviously reads Chinese and I don't, told me in Chinese, which was, it was actually a scene of a high school teacher who walked on their evacuation with a blackboard hanging down his back so that his students could continue with their day's lesson and not lose a minute of their education.
Yeah.
And the words, the day's lesson hanging down his back, it just stuck with me so much in the Chinese, and that was the English part of it.
Because the weight of it and the weight of his responsibilities. I mean, you can see it so clearly, and also the courage that it takes in not letting them fall to the wayside. It would be very easy to just let that go, just concentrate on survival, but they didn't. They kept working to educate these children. From Anna has a question. She said she absolutely loves the character of Sparrow and the legend of the Willow Star and the Prince. Can you elaborate on where that part of the story evolved from?
Okay, so in Chinese mythology, there's a really, really popular folk tale, and it's called The Ox Herd and the Heavenly Weaver Girl. Mm-hmm. And it's every culture has some type of a story of some heavenly being coming down to earth, falling in love with mortals, you know. And in the story of the ox herd and the heavenly weaver girl, she is the weaving maid to the queen mother of heaven. She comes down to take a look around the earth, falls in love with this handsome young guy who, you know, like herds ox. And unfortunately, she is not allowed to stay on earth. She has to go back up into the heavens. But she goes back up into the heavens, but she cries so much at being separated that, you know, her tears, which are like stardust, completely cloud the constellations so that navigation becomes impossible, like celestial navigation becomes impossible. And the Queen Mother of Heaven says, oh, all right. So once a year, the heavenly weaving maid and her lover are allowed to meet across the Bridge of Birds, which is when all the birds of China fly into the heavens and they create a bridge for the young lovers to walk across and meet each other. And this is a folk tale that has now been packaged and marketed as Chinese Valentine's Day. So I felt that there was a precedence in Chinese mythology, not to mention mythology in so many other cultures, for a celestial and mortal love story. And I invented the story of the Willow Star that way.
Well, and also you're reclaiming, how should I put it? You know, the Valentine's Day for a noble purpose, as opposed to just selling greeting cards and overpriced red roses. I think that there could be no, you know, you've elevated it in a literary sense. There's one more, and this is making me laugh. From just an anonymous attendee, how many unpublished and or half finished books do you have? Do you want to go? You go first, Janie. It's about you.
I have a one and a half. And I have to tell you, the one is actually kind of a funny story because, you know how your first pancake is always really bad and your first novel that you think you know how to write is really bad. And the funny thing is, I sent it in to Kevin, who is now my agent, right? And so this is 10 years ago. And she sent me back this lovely, lovely rejection letter.
Yeah.
And then when I met her a few years ago at the Historical Novel Society thing, I said, you know, Kevin, I don't know if you remember this, but, you know, because I was already published and I had another literary agent.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, but Kevin, I sent you my, and she goes, oh no, I hope I was nice to you. I said, you were wonderful. You were absolutely wonderful. Yeah, yeah. But it was that bad. And actually, June, it's what made me decide when I was ready to start another novel again, that I just had to go and take a creative writing class, because there's just so much with craft, you know, like how do you plot the arc of a story? Mm-hmm. How do you plot, you know, sub arcs? How do you do character development? Like, how do you keep the pace of it going? So
the planning, I have to say, is eternally torture for me. I just find it torturous. The first draft is a nightmare. It's a complete nightmare. People, and you know, you'll meet writers, and I have friends who say they love doing the first draft, love it, and it's the editing that's the nightmare. And I'm completely the reverse.
I love having
sent in that first draft to my editor. I love hearing what she thinks and then working with her to craft the book into its final version, which is always radically different from the first draft. And characters, I lose characters, I add characters, there's timelines that come and go. But, you know, Kevin, our agent, is part of that too.
And it's so, that's where it really helps to have a group of friends, and especially it's wonderful to have a group of historical author friends, because then, you know, you can moan about this and they understand, you know. I mean, it's so important to have good author friendships, because they really are the only people who will understand that when you say to them, I don't know if I can do third person point of view. I mean, they're not going to look at you like you're a nutcase. They will, you know, pour you some Prosecco and say, there, you'll get through it. And, you know, here's a good book. Here's a good book that, you know, uses, you know, third person and switches between different points of view, and it works really well. Yeah.
I'm always wary of feeling as if when I talk to quote unquote civilians, as in like people who don't make up imaginary people for a living.
They can laugh at us. They can totally laugh at us.
Yeah, I'm wary that they're going to say, you're being such a, you know, my husband will tease me sometimes in the nicest possible way and call me the delicate artist as I'm having one of my days. But it is, you know, that's what passes for stress in our world. And it, you know, it's a pretty good place to be. I mean, even things you and I were talking about this the other day, Janie, like COVID and the restrictions that everyone is living through. I mean, as a writer, you're already used to kind of sitting alone in a room.
Yeah.
I mean, the only thing I can say, this is not a complaint, it's an observation, is that quite often, you know, in the before times, I would look for a change of scenery, and I would go and sit in there's a little independent coffee shop around the corner from me. And I would go and sit there and write for, you know, maybe one afternoon a week, sometimes two, if I was feeling really, you know, really spendthrift. And and that, you know, obviously I can't do, but that's not something that I, in my estimation, is really worth even moaning about. I mean, for the coffee shop, yes, but not for, you know, my inability to go and sit there and think my delicate artist thoughts, you know. And I will, I mean, I guess for research purposes, I know it's curtailed some of your research into your work in progress, but you know, you have a researcher helping you out right now. So
yes, I hired a grad student from the University of Paris so that she can do some of the legwork and the French, and you know, like she wrote to the mayor of the town that I'm researching, right, and asked about materials. So
yeah,
things that I can't do for myself now. Of course, I would have preferred going to France on my own. But
well, I know, and we did have like there were murmurs a while back that you and I and Kate would all converge and maybe possibly a rental that would be for work purposes, completely legitimate expenses. Yeah. And well, I mean, at the end of the day, as long as, you know, we're able to turn out books that will entertain and possibly inform people a little bit, I think that's, you know, that's what could be better as a writer, right? I mean,
all in all, I still feel really, really lucky. And I am still constantly amazed that people actually want to read something that I've written. Yeah.
It's the constant pinch me. Is this really happening? And you know, I think that this book, I should add too, it came out at the height of the pandemic, like in April. Yeah. Your whole book tour had to be canceled and events moved and put online. But it was a Book of the Month Club selection in the United States, which is a big deal, a very, very big deal. And it was a bestseller. So I think if anything, I mean, you know, anyone who's read one of your books knows that anything they pick up by you is going to be splendid. That's my new favorite word right now, splendid. But you know, the success of this book confirms even when it was almost impossible for anyone to get to a bookstore and it was still selling well is really commendable.
Thank you so much, Jen. I think we need to stop the gab fest.
I know. It's the mutual.
This is what happens, you know.
Well, I think we've come, unless there's anybody wants to chime in with a final question, I think we're coming up at the end of our time here. I have a terrible tendency to go over, but I think I've hit my mark, Sheila. I feel so proud of myself.
Janie and Jennifer, thank you so much for your conversations, your story, and your insights. It's lovely to listen in on conversations of authors that know and support each other, and your friendship and your warmth just shone through the screen. So thanks for being here tonight.
Thank you for inviting us.
Yes, thank you so much.
And as we were talking about before the event started, and as you just mentioned, these book launches and author visits are important. And yes, we have many responsibilities and stresses, and yes, many Zoom meetings. But just like as readers, we can choose to read as an escape, these conversations and opportunities to listen to and celebrate and meet you virtually are wonderful, and they're a needed distraction as well. So thanks for your time and visiting us at Kitchener Library. And when you're ready, ladies, I'm happy to launch your Jen and Janie nerd hour. So please, anytime.
Wonderful. Thank you, Sheila.
Thank you, Sheila. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.
And as mentioned in the beginning, we extend our thanks and want to give a shout out to Wordsworth Books. They have been supporting all of our 85 Queen online events, and we appreciate their presence in our community. I encourage you to continue to support your independent bookstore with your personal and gift-giving book purchases. And if you haven't, go out and grab one of these. And to each of you attending tonight, thank you for your support of the library during this time. Please be sure to check your email tomorrow, because two lucky attendees from tonight's event will receive a copy of the Library of Legends for joining us tonight. We appreciate your continuing online attendance, and I invite you back in the coming weeks for events with our writer in residence, Kamal Al-Solai Lee, and book events with authors Adam Naiman and Stephen Hayden. And we have some virtual music performances in partnership with students from the Faculty of Music at Wilfrid Laurier. Have a great night and a safe week. Bye for now.